Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. A warm welcome to our session, Maharashtra, Driving Force of the Indian Economy. We are honored to have such eminent panel with us today. Our dynamic Minister for Industries and Mining, Shri Subhash Desai Ji, Shri Sailesh Hari Bhakti Ji, an eminent Chartered Accountant and Chairman, Key Companies India, Shri Keval Handa Ji, Non-Executive Chairman of Union Bank of India, and one of the leading public sector banks of India, Shri Yogesh Agarwal, the young dynamic MD of Ajanta Pharma. Before we start our session, I just like to give a few salient features of Maharashtra which make it so different from the other states in India. Maharashtra, the most industrialized state in India, the highest GDP state in India of approximately $400 billion. Attracts 33% of the total FDI in India. MIDC, largest land bank in India. Abundant skilled manpower. Third major hub, IT hub in India. Mumbai, the commercial entertainment and fashion center of India. New World Health Wealthiest City Worldwide list of 2019 ranks Mumbai as the 12th richest city in the world with a wealth estimated at $960 billion. Magnetic Maharashtra 2.0, launched last week by our dynamic government, already has seen deals worth 16,000 crores, approximately $2.1 billion. I'm sure we are all eagerly waiting to hear our panelists. I won't take much of your time. I'll request our Honorable Industry Minister to address us, give his opening remarks.
Yes, good afternoon, Mr. Rajiv Ji, Shailesh Ji, Agarwal Ji, other gentlemen. Thank you very much for organizing this online conference. And I appreciate efforts of Horesis, independent international think tank. They are always putting their best efforts to bring together the talents and thinkers across the globe on one platform. Today we are virtually meeting and just sharing our views. Maharashtra, as you rightly said, is on the forefront of industrial and economic development of India, and 15% Indian GDP is shared by Maharashtra, more than 33% share in export is the Maharashtra's significant role, and of course all the manufacturing hubs are present here. We still want to take it forward, and we are very, very busy now. We have come back to business, even in this corona-impacted conditions. We are back to business. Recently, our Honorable Chief Minister headed a conference where we signed MOUs worth rupees 16,000 crores with global companies from different countries. And now we are all set to implement these MOUs. Every MOU signed now is being implemented or converted into actual industries. For this, we have made certain reforms. We are always pursuing the excellence in businesses, and we want to address every issue of the investors. This is the reason why Maharashtra is called Magnetic Maharashtra. We have we have with us our new initiatives. First is master license. The single window has been the practice of all the states in India. But we have now taken a step forward and we are a step ahead. This master license or Mahaparvana will ensure one single license within 48 hours of signing agreement with the government and booking land parcel. This will take care of all the licenses, and the investor can launch their construction, or if the shed is ready, they can bring in machineries and launch production. All other licenses will be released during their course of production. They don't have to wait till every license is obtained. So this master license system will take care of all the licenses at one go. Our second initiative is providing relationship manager or Udyog Mitra to every investor. He will be hand-holding with the investors from the first day of signing agreement till the day the unit goes into production. So this relationship manager or our Udyog Mitra will be responsible to address each and every issue, small or big, raised by the investors. We have plug and play system in place now. Nearly 40,000 acres industrial land fully developed with road connectivity, power supply, water supply, and all the necessary infrastructure ready for industries to step in. We have again introduced new scheme of providing built-up sheds for industries. MIDC will invest in constructing these sheds and they will be made available on rentals. So people don't have to invest in the construction of the buildings. Now Maharashtra will be ready to provide built-up sheds for the industries. So this is a really plug and play method of attracting industries. We have made special reforms by introducing Industrial Employment Bureau. This Industrial Employment Bureau will provide skilled manpower to the industries, will enroll on one side the job seekers and other side the job givers. Both job givers and both job seekers will come on one platform. We will also provide skill development small courses to the job seekers and will make them employable. So these initiatives will certainly add feathers to our cap, and Maharashtra will be in real terms magnetic Maharashtra. With all these initiatives, we are now busy negotiating with investors from different countries as well as from other parts of India, who are seriously negotiating with industry officials for their future plans. So we are here and all of you are here. I invite you. We are looking to the total unlock, and let us be prepared to meet each other in one room instead of meeting online. Many times these days we are trying to meet online, and these are virtual meetings. The actual meetings will also take place, and I assure you all the cooperation, and we'll understand your concerns. We'll definitely take note of each and every suggestion made by friends. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, and I look forward to your active participation in the growth of Maharashtra. Thank you very much. Jai Maharashtra.
I think Rajiv ji, you have to unmute yourself.
Sorry, somebody had asked to mute and I'm sorry. Thank you so much, sir, for those insights. And Maharashtra has been very dynamic and in the front. We know the numbers are increasing, but the government is taking very proactive steps. And I'm sure soon the transport will also open up in the sense of trains. It's already opened up for essential commodities. And once that comes, then it will be much easier for the people coming to office. I'll come back to you, sir, for discussion. In the meantime, I request Shailesh Bhai to give his introductory remarks, please. Unmute, Shailesh Bhai, unmute, please.
Namaskar, everybody. It's a great pleasure, Santosh ji, to interact with you. What a fantastic outline you have given for all the great initiatives our super state, magnetic state, has taken. I've been given 3 minutes to make 3 points, so I'll make them quickly. My first point, sir, is it possible for us to create the infrastructure of low-cost, very high-speed downloadable internet for our whole state? Can Maharashtra be the first completely Wi-Fi state of this country? It is within our reach to do so. Why do I say that? Sir, it will support e-learning for K-12, for our universities, and for lifelong learning. It will also support our thrust to be physically fit with yoga, with personal hygiene, with telehealth, and with all the other e-governance mechanisms that you kind of referred to, but which will need to be implemented. This can happen only if we have ubiquitous Wi-Fi throughout our state. Nobody should be left behind in having access to high-speed downloadable internet. This can transform our state in ways that only leaves it to our imagination. My second policy change would be to give our MSMEs the widest berth in terms of 4 clear things that need to be done in addition to the entire set of provisions that have already been made. Today, MSMEs are in such a difficult stage that it is not enough to give them incremental leverage. It is very important to give them first-time debt, equity, necessary assets, and technology, and make sure that their working capital cycle is never halted because the flow of money has stopped, either from the central government or the state government or the large industries or anybody else in the value chain until the money finally reaches the MSME. The largest users of your job exchange, sir, which you referred to, will be the MSME sector. 90% of all employment in India is provided by the MSME sector. And if we as a state can make sure that these 4 things are provided to all MSMEs, liquidity, debt, equity, assets, and technology. If we can do this, and this is not going to cost our government too much, it is going to be possible for us to make these outlays within very reasonable outlays, particularly the outlays that your ministry, the industry ministry, has already actually made available. And finally, my third point, I think we should now hyper-localize development. Why should Maharashtra not be the first state in the country to remove populations and industries from congested places like our Dharavi and other places and create 25 smart cities? Sir, it is not important to have only an industrial estate. It is important to have a whole smart city re-established in order for people to live there, educate themselves, entertain themselves, learn over there, do everything together. It is critical that we hyper-localize Maharashtra. Maharashtra has to bloom in 5,000 cases, not only in our cities. It has to happen through 100 new smart cities coming up almost every year. Again, this is something that I know you and I have discussed somewhere in the past, but it is important that we have a policy directive to make sure that this actually comes into being, because that will really make growth flourish in a way that you will be pleased, Maharashtra will be pleased, and the whole country will notice as an example to be followed. And if you follow through with hyper-localization, we will be able to make sure that markets get hyper-localized, that goods get hyper-localized, that even availability of all products and services, including the making of our own vegetables, salads, fruits in nearby localities, and it being delivered efficiently to our homes, can all be facilitated by your policy directions. I would urge you, sir, to do these three things. Make internet available to everybody in the state of Maharashtra. Make it the first Wi-Fi state of the country. Two, support MSME completely with liquidity, debt, equity, and the assets as well as technology. And finally, hyper-localized development so that we have 1,000 flowers blooming all over our state. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shailesh Bhai, for your insights. Very, very useful. We'll come to that in the panel discussion and hear more from you. I'll request Mr. Handa to give his introductory remarks, please. Unmute yourself, sir.
Very good afternoon to all of you. I'm very fortunate that I was involved in the Maharashtra development in the 70s and 80s. I was part of the State Industrial Corporation, setting up industries in the MIDC areas. And we set up some global companies like Bharat Forge. And I'm still very passionate about Maharashtra. And I'm very happy to see that we have this support that we did it in the past have been carried forward, and there has been a good growth. In fact, the industrial sector of Maharashtra contributes almost 33% of the state GDP. Sir, in good old days, the industries were sugar, the pharmaceuticals, the chemicals, textiles, these were the industries. The new industrial policy has defined a green wave industries, industries which are quite IT-enabled industries. For example, electric vehicles. In Industry 4, which is talks about artificial intelligence, nanotechnology, augmented technologies.
I think Kevalji has some internet problem and he's dropped out. He'll come in and I'll probably request him to continue. In the meanwhile, can I request Yogesh Ji to give his introductory remarks, please?
Hello, good afternoon, everyone. Let me give you a perspective from the pharmaceutical industry. Today, the pharma industry in India is about $40 billion, out of which $20 billion is in India, domestic market, and $20 billion is exports. We are $11 billion net trade surplus industry. As an industry, we give $11 billion to the country in the trade surplus. I think more than 150 to 180 countries are reached from Indian medicines. So, Indian pharma industry clearly has traveled a long way.
And the projects that get implemented, we need to look into it, why there is a gap. And this could be a good starting point, because you still have almost about 44% all of projects which are initiated, out of which only 24% investment has come. And still there is 56% which have not yet been initiated. I would really urge you to look into this and say, what is lacking? Why, after signing it, they are not coming to Maharashtra? Maharashtra badly needs double-digit growth, sir. Our growth rate has slowed down. And our growth rate should be above the Indian growth rate. And we need to really look at all sectors to get the growth rate. It's only when you are able to get the double-digit growth that you will find enough of money to invest on all that Harish Shailesh, my friend, has spoken about. Shailesh did talk about MSMEs. Today, when you move to Industry 4, they want to have an integrated digital platform. All our MSMEs are analog, sir. An analog cannot service a digital platform. In order to make them, enable them to serve the digital platform, it is necessary that they go digital. Now, to convert all the analogs into digital is going to be a very expensive affair. However, technology is available today. You put the platform on the top of the digital and make enable them to be go on the platform and analog.
He's having some internet issues. I'm sorry, Yogeshji. We had took a. Should we just carry on or should we wait for him?
I think.
Let's wait and just see in case he comes in again.
Yeah, for the benefit of the, I think, the entire audience, let's continue. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry.
As I was saying, I was setting the context for the pharma industry. We are a $40 billion. $20 billion in India and $20 billion export. And we are one of the industry which has the trade surplus of $11 billion. We reach to about 150 to 180 countries worldwide. Clearly, India has traveled a long way in the pharma space. We've traditionally grown high single digit to a low double digit. We've grown around 8 to 12% year after year compounded for, I think, more than a decade now. And we don't see that any reason why we should not continue to grow at the same pace going forward. I think barring the bump which we are seeing in the COVID, but again, COVID has impacted the pharma industry. And the reason why I say that this kind of growth is possible is that if you look, all the indicators of the India points towards this hyper growth. If we say our healthcare spend to the GDP is around 3%. If we see the spend of China is almost twice as ours, and if we see Europe and US, it is 11 to 12%, four times. If we see the patient to the bed ratio is one of the lowest in India. And if we see the doctor to population, that ratio is one of the lowest. We have one doctor per thousand, whereas in the Europe, we have four doctors per thousand. Our insurance is one of the most underpenetrated in the world. Having said this, I'm setting a context that Indian pharma industry is poised to grow at 8 to 12% for foreseeable future. And we believe that if we are able to grow at 8%, the pharma industry in 10 years could be $80 billion, 2x of what we are. And if we are able to grow at 11 to 12%, our pharma industry could be $120 billion.
Thank you very much.
And if you can imagine, if we have to service this kind of growth, which will be domestic India as well as exports, what kind of capacity we will be requiring to create in India? Clearly, India has emerged as a place of choice because of the skill set we possess, because of the capabilities which have come, because of the quality standards which India pharma industry has developed. Clearly, these capacities have to be built in India, I think a big part. And we see that I think Maharashtra is poised to take a really great space in that area. Currently, around 30% of the pharmaceutical is produced in Gujarat, and Maharashtra stands at 22%. And thereafter, Telangana and Himachal and some other states, they are following. But clearly, if we are to grow, which we will grow in the pharma space, and if this kind of capex is going to happen, and this kind of job creation is going to happen in the next decade, I feel that Maharashtra is really poised. We have four facilities in Maharashtra, clear to near to Aurangabad. And I can tell you with our experience that it has an excellent industrial atmosphere, great work environment, and various other factors like power surplus and all those things. So I see a great, great opportunity for Maharashtra to encash in next decade in the pharma space.
Thank you very much, Yogesh. Thank you for your insights. I think Kevin again got.
Rajivji.
Sir.
Can I mention something?
Please, sir. Please.
See, I have another event to attend. of course, online. I'm really thankful to Mr. Shailesh ji for his insights and his concrete suggestions to make Maharashtra Wi-Fi ready. That is the need of the hour. We are also considering and working on those lines. I don't know when it will be really complete, but this is a very, very good suggestion, and this will make Maharashtra totally in line with the world-class infrastructure. We have to address this issue of Wi-Fi. Then MSMEs. Government of India has announced recently the huge package, and there are certain points on MSME, but we are still not aware of the details. What are the features of those schemes? But still, we are preparing our own scheme, Maharashtra scheme for MSMEs, and I'm just waiting for our cabinet's nod, and in about a week's time, this should be announced. So MSMEs, we are taking utmost care to support them in this difficult time, and we will try to reduce their burden as far as possible. Then smart cities. This is another suggestion made by Shailesh Bhai, and we have to certainly think on those lines. Of course, the government of India's ambitious scheme of creating 100 smart cities across the country is different from what Mr. Shailesh Bhai is suggesting, and it should offer end-to-end solution to the life of all the people concerned. So the smart cities, MSMEs, Wi-Fi, all these three points are very close to our hearts, and slowly but surely we will come back to you, and if need be, we would certainly like to understand more details on these lines. Mr. Yogesh Bhai, you have spoken of pharma, and this is very, very important part of our industrial growth. The India's growth story cannot be complete without mentioning pharma as a leading sector. Of course, I can assure you that with the government of India's announcement of introducing a scheme of bulk drug parks, of course, they are ready to offer three bulk drug parks. We have suggested that the number should be increased, and Maharashtra is ready to have such bulk drug park in the state. We are also ready to develop a pharma park as near as possible near to Mumbai, a model pharma park where you would also like to participate. We will unroll the features of this scheme, and pharmaceuticals. Actually, Maharashtra is the first state to introduce infrastructure specially created for pharma industries in the country. And slowly, other states also joined this story. But now we want to take a step forward. And this will be our major step and very, very ambitious scheme to create model pharmaceutical park in the state. Most probably it would be created in district Raigad, the nearest district to Mumbai. And of course, other issues are relevant, and we are beginning to open up now. And slowly, I am sure we'll come to the normalcy. The life would go on. The life should go on. And now, to bridge the gap, we must run to achieve our goals. Mr. Rajivji, If you allow me, can I join my other webinar?
How can I refuse? There were but lots of questions people wanted to ask. What we'll do is we'll compile them and we'll email it to you for because there are lots of questions which I can see on my screen. But I do understand. Thank you so much for joining us and sparing your time. We do understand the pressure. We'll, with your permission, we'll continue the panel. And thank you once again, sir.
Continue and share your views.
We will, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Oh, I think Keval Bhai Sahab has dropped out. I mean, in the sense he's having some net issues. So I'll take the Sanjeev. You mentioned, you know, the three areas which were infrastructure. For I mean, basically, you were talking of the Wi-Fi and the MSMEs and the hyper location development. Now, is there anything you think on the policy changes to attract more foreign investments, given that, you know, many companies from China want to leave and come and they're looking for other destinations? So earlier when, you know, there was a report on which said that out of 63 companies, only 3 companies came to India. So what can India do and specifically Maharashtra do to attract these companies to Maharashtra and bring them here?
Can you hear me, Rajiv?
I can hear you, sir.
Yeah. So I would say 3 things are important. Number one, we should make Maharashtra a speedy litigation closure state. We can become number one in the country. No litigation in Maharashtra should remain outstanding for more than 6 months. That should become the new law of Maharashtra. And there are 4 ways of doing it. Number one, we take a full machine learning data of all cases outstanding. As many cases as we can pull together, and this can be done all India. I'm just giving Maharashtra as an example. For example, in Negotiable Instruments Act, antiquated, 25% of all litigation in this country is on Negotiable Instruments Act. I can close this litigation in 3 months. There are only 6, we already identified 6 ways to solve. There is no 7th way to solve. We can take those cases robotically without any judge. We can close 25% of all litigation. Second, we need to make sure that when a case is launched, if there is already a precedent, there should be an instantaneous judgment, which does not lead to costly litigation happening. Where litigation happens within the first hearing, arbitration should be ordered, and arbitration must close within a 3-month period. We must reduce the time span for closure of these disputes. People cannot be permitted to keep asking for delayed next hearing, that has to stop. So to my mind, the first thing that we need to do to attract international investment is to have a dispute resolution mechanism which is speedy, which is fair, which is absolutely efficient. Very critical. Number two, to attract FDI, is to make sure that there will never be any restriction on repatriation. Nobody will come with their money to India if there is any chance of there being an issue on repatriation. Also, the governments should take a vow that no retrospective legislation will be put into place. In Maharashtra, we should bring a standstill to all state and local laws and make all of them e-governed. If we do this, the enabling environment would have been created. And finally, most importantly, we should create Mumbai as a financial center of the world. If we can, and this is, we have already got the entire report, which was produced some 14 years ago. All we need to do is some powerful agency to update that report to bring in all the modern technologies, to bring in artificial intelligence, machine learning, blockchain, big data analytics, sub-lake, we must bring that to a conclusion. And we should not have any debates. A powerful minister like Santosh Bhai should be requested to implement. No questions, don't have seminars, don't have all this rubbish to keep delaying the process. Straight implementation, make Mumbai a financial center. Clean up the mess on litigation, clean up the mess on procedural and delays and change of law and regulation, close it. And you see, you will get 10x. I can guarantee personally 10x investment coming into Maharashtra.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ajay Rai, for that insight. We'll definitely put it up to the Honorable Minister. And some of these will have to be, of course, addressed by the center. So it will be have to be mixed between center and state. Yogeshji, you know, on the pharmaceutical, that excellent what you told us. And you see the growth prospects of the pharmaceutical sector. But, you know, post-COVID, there's a lot of opportunities which have come up. What are the opportunities you feel and what are the hurdles? More specifically with Maharashtra, you said Gujarat has almost 30% of the industry. So what is lacking in Maharashtra where we could do to make it more vibrant in the pharmaceutical sector?
So I think with the COVID, one thing we have realized is that though pharma industry in India, they have gained tremendous strengths in the formulations, which is the finished products, and also largely to a value-added raw materials, which is what we call API. But certain parts, certain kind of APIs, which are fermentation-based, like penicillins, we are really dependent on China for a few reasons. Question is, do we have that technology or not? Yes, we have the technology. India, we used to manufacture and produce these products. But somehow, China became more cost-efficient and we could not compete with them. And that is the reason these kind of industries, the market share was taken from China. So what I think Indian pharma industry is trying to do now with the help of the government is try to see how we can revive these API or intermediate manufacturing back to India so that we have a self-reliant country for all these kind of penicillins, antibiotics, paracetamol, all these kind of products. And there is already an initiative by the central government of India where they have announced a 10,000 crores fiscal incentive for the pharma industry who wants to take the initiative and bring this kind of manufacturing in India. Clearly, I think when this will come to India, there are four or five states to my mind which stands out as to be the places where people would like to go. And for sure, Maharashtra is one of the leading states. As you rightly said, Gujarat is second, Telangana is third. There's no, I think, you know, the thing that what is required by the corporates. You need ease of business. You need someone who can give you, you need land to put up the facilities. And as our minister, honorable minister said that they are making the provisions for the land. We need land. We need power. We need connectivity because we know that I think right now the transport cost in India is higher as compared to China. If you say the transporting cost per kilometer, per kg is higher in our country. And if we have to really compete with China or any other economy for that matter, we have to see that how we remove these inefficiencies and become the cost efficient. So clearly, I think these are the few things. If we have the availability of the manpower, of the land, of the power and road connectivity, I think clearly Maharashtra can stand to be a place of choice for anyone who's coming in. The advantage Maharashtra has is a very strong industrial culture. Let me tell you, I think we having four facilities in Maharashtra, I can really tell you with confidence and authority that there is a tremendous understanding on how the industry should work. So the industrial disputes or understanding, they're handled in really great harmony. So these are the views. I think the opportunities are enormous. API one, and as I've already shared in my opening comments, if the capacities have to be built for the growth of Indian pharma industry in coming decades, again, I see there's a lot of capex, you know, the job creations and various things which can happen. It may happen maybe a year or two, because we have to see how the COVID kind of evolves and sets, and how we open up the economies and growth revive back. But long-term horizon is very positive.
Thank you, Yogeshi. Thank you so much. I think, you know, we've got another 5 minutes before we conclude. So I thought, you know, we can go on, and, you know, pharmaceutical, very interesting subject. And of course, what Shailesh Bhai spoke also equally, and we can keep debating this. But I thought, you know, just for the benefit of our viewers, COVID has changed the way of doing business and living. What, as per you, and I'll address it to both of you and one by one, of course, what do you see as the biggest opportunity you foresee in the future? If you could give us two opportunities and tell us why this would be the future opportunities. I start with Shailesh Bhai.
Rajiv, you're a very strict person. Teen ka do kar diya. चलिए अभी हम आपको दो ही आइडिया देते हैं.
नहीं नहीं तीन दीजिए शैलेश भाई. वी डोंट हैव केवल भाई साहब, सो यू कैन कवर अप फॉर हिम.
बट आई मस्ट एको व्हाट योगेश भाई सेड. आई थिंक वी हैव अ फैंटास्टिक अपॉर्चुनिटी इन महाराष्ट्र, बिकॉज महाराष्ट्र इज द ओनली प्लेस वेयर आई कैन रेकमेंड व्हाट आई एम नाउ रेकमेंडिंग, दैट कन्वर्ट ऑल मैन्युफैक्चरिंग, ऑल नो एक्सेप्शन, to 3D printing based additive manufacturing. Bring in absolutely the most modern technology of manufacturing, because we have the skilled labor force, we have infrastructure, we have a supportive government, so we can do this. Iske liye jo, what will be the first few resources required are available from the budget of the government of Maharashtra. Let us use it and let us draw money from wherever we can to bring in additive manufacturing. Subtractive manufacturing is history and we need to bury it. It is too inefficient. We can save 10% of our cost in simply the material that we waste. We can save another 10% in all the returns and rework and all the other rubbish that we do. If our cost can fall by 20%, we will be the world's leading manufacturer in virtually everything that Maharashtra can produce. So that would be my first recommendation. Second, let us move to vertical agriculture. Our farmers have shown an amazing ability to adapt. We need to make 90% of all Maharashtra's agriculture non-rain dependent. And one of the ways to do that is to bring in vertical agriculture. Let us use all the learnings of Israel on drip irrigation. Let us use all the learnings of the world on LED lighting, on swift plant growth, on hydroponics, on aeroponics, on making sure that people can grow in small spaces, whatever they need to consume. And finally, because you've given me three, I'll give you the thought that we should stop the brutality on all animals. All meat should be converted to stem cell driven, artificially produced, equally fresh and equally good tasting if people want meat. But I think that that is a huge opportunity to make sure that we stop the cruelty to animals and make sure that we get the same nutrition and the same protein and the same value without causing brutality and death. So these would be my three top recommendations for Maharashtra.
Thank you, sir. A lot of food for thought.
I think I see there is only 4 minutes left in the session, so I'll quickly wrap up. Shailesh has already taken on the agriculture and the manufacturing. To me, clearly, the new age economy, which is our technology or digital, that seems to be a clear opportunity. And we've already seen the amazing job which was done by the Reliance. And we've seen what kind of money is available. And money is available from all parts of the world, whether it's Middle East, whether it's US, Facebook. So if there is a great idea and you are able to take it forward and scale it up, clearly shows that if you have good execution, good management, and you're able to bring the idea and make it happen, there's a lot of money available there in the market. So I see there is a great opportunity in the technology new age. which seems to be going forward in the COVID kind of scenario, I think in the foreseeable future, till the time we have vaccines coming in, would be a very important part of our lives. I think we cannot do away with the parcels reaching to our doors through the suppliers like Flipkarts or Amazons or technology like that. So clearly, I think there is a place for the Indian technology firms to kind of play the roles. And there is a lot of other exciting things happening in the world, which is the artificial intelligence and, you know, so on and so forth. So I think clearly the head start which we have in the technology and IT front, I think India has a great opportunity in that front. We have to have a great idea and a great execution.
Thank you so, so much, Mukeshji. I think we are just bang on time to close the session. I must thank both of you. I must thank our Honorable Minister, who is not with us now, and Kevalji for joining us and sparing your time. Would also like to thank our friend Frank for organizing this excellent meet of ours. It's very, very impressive. There are such good sessions throughout the day, and I'm sure our viewers are enjoying it. I'm sorry we could not address a lot of questions which were asked. Please feel free to address them to me or to Horaces, and we'll get the response from our panelists. Finally, thank you very, very much for this insightful session. With this, I say goodbye. Thank you.